Maybe just, can you just stand at this mic? Yeah.
If it's good, it's grand. So let me know what you know to do in the comments. that's Wednesday at 7. I'm also doing every household visit. My folks are going to have to move every household in the congregation. At the moment, I'm doing those visits to justify really all the church offices against the schedule of one of the meetings with me. I've got time slots, Tuesdays and Thursday evenings, and Wednesday afternoons. So, since we are worshiping primarily virtually, and they do go to one of the offering, so if you give your offering to the church, to support the ministries that you do, you can do that online at our website. Then you can mail your offering to the church. Thank you to everyone who gives to the church consistently. During this difficult time, when you can't do the church, especially for the past year, just kind of get this done and awesome job that's supposed to be the church. If you are new to the church, and you are visiting us online, and you want more information about the congregation, you can visit our website at adventchurchgrove.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Instagram. Without further ado, blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the keeper of the covenant, the source of steadfast love, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. God hears us when we cry and draws us close in Jesus Christ. Let us return to the one who is full of compassion. Fountain of living water, pour out your mercy over us. Our sin is heavy, and we long to be cured. Rebuild what we have ruined, and mend what we have torn. Wash us in your cleansing blood. Make us alive in the Spirit, to follow the way of Jesus, as healers and restorers of the world you so love. Amen. Beloved, God
Genesis chapter 9. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I made between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and that shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh, and the water shall never again become flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that is on Psalm 25. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul.
My God, you put my trust in you. Let me not be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me.
Let none who look to you be put to shame. Rather, let those be put to shame who are treacherous.
Show me your way, O the Lord, and teach me your
truth. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation, and you I have trusted all the day long. Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Remember me according to your steadfast love and for the sake of forgiveness, O Lord.
You are gracious and upright, O Lord. Therefore, you teach sinners in your way.
You lead the lowly in justice and teach the lowly your way. All your paths, O Lord, are steadfast love and faithfulness to those who keep your covenant and your testimonies. The second reading is from 1 Peter chapter 3. Christ also suffered for sins once for all, for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, persons were saved through water and baptism, which this prefigured now saves you. Not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. Here ends the reading.
Repent and believe in the good news, the gospel of we embark upon the season of kindness and self-reflection, I give that the goal from here to you. Bless us. At this time, we will hold your spirit, that you may draw us near with your love. In the thoughts and meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable to you. Amen.
So we've got this short passage out of the Gospel
according to Mark.
And again, this year.
Our lesson, it's the year of Mark.
And
I know I've mentioned it before, that Mark is the shortest gospel. He's to the point. He goes from one thing to the next. Jesus is always in the right. And again, in our text, this week,
we've got detail
as the other Gospels. And those days Jesus came to the Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John and John the Baptist.
No
conversations between John and Jesus in this verse.
And immediately he's driven out into the wilderness to be tempted by Satan for 40 days. We have none of
the dialogue between Jesus and Satan in this gospel, whereas we do in the
others.
He's waited upon by angels. And now after John was arrested, Jesus comes and came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The kingdom of God has come here. Repent
and believe in the good news. So we begin. Today's gospel lesson.
And Lent is about remembering our baptism, and it's about repenting. And these two things go hand in hand. They go hand in hand. We need both. They're much upon both.
You know, I think
a lot of Christians, most traditions, they tend to think of Lent if they have any formation and Lenten disciplines and what the season of Lent is about. Most people think about repentance more.
I think
baptism kind of gets left behind. But let's talk about repentance first, to understand how baptism and repentance go hand in hand with one another. But the word repentance means to repent. To repent. If you think of a farmer or a shepherd with a flock of sheep or of cows, any type of livestock, you have pens, you have enclosures, you have fenced in areas. And those fenced in areas are important. You might have different fields that are fenced in. You will transfer your animals from one field to the other field so that the one field can the grass can grow back and the animals can eat here and you can transfer over. You might have a smaller fence to gather the animals where they're closer together. They're easier to reach. You don't have to walk across the entire field in order to tend to your animals.
To look
after them. That if they're injured, you help them heal. That you groom them. That you maintain their health. Is to be repent, to be brought back into the fold, into the enclosure, this place of relationship between the farmer or the caretaker and the flock.
That can't happen
if you are outside of the pen, where the shepherd has to go after you, to go find you somewhere else. Repentance is about more than just saying, I'm sorry. But it's about re-entering, re-establishing, renewing connection and relationship, and standing in the confines of what good relationship is.
Those of you who tuned in
for the Ash Wednesday service,
and piety being about right relationship.
Right relationship happens in the closure of the relationship. The rules of engagement, how we relate and connect
with one another, that we
love each other
instead of hurt each other. Sheep saying,
well, you know, I'm really sorry I wandered away, but I really don't feel like going back. Well, the food is not as good, the medical care and the grooming is not as good. There are predators out there that will eat you. You're not protected. No, to re-enter, to repent is to go back with the shepherd to the safe place.
The place where you're cared for, looked after. Attacked.
That if you admit that you are wrong, and you're the only person in the room who admits they're wrong, and everyone else says, well, I'm right. Oh, look, somebody who admitted that they're wrong, let's lay down on hard on that. Let's bring it upon that. The fact is, nobody in the room is without sin. And it is a human pattern that when we have sin, you jump on pointing out somebody else's sin. It's always been that way. We just look at Adam and Eve. They eat of the forbidden fruit of the tree.
They're ashamed of their nakedness. They're hiding from God because of their sin.
And when God confronts them, what does Adam do?
He says,
she made me do it. No, Adam. God told you first, you knew better. Don't give me that.
In a
world of whataboutism,
you damn yourself if you admit that you've done wrong. You damn yourself if you apologize. It is countercultural to not
only repent,
but just to merely admit, I made a mistake, I did wrong. You get jumped on. Cancel
culture kind of finds its roots in
social
media, social networking, where you know you can like and unlike those around you. That if somebody disagrees with you or points out a flaw in your heatedly expressed opinion online, instead of actually
engaging in real conversation,
it's easier to shout it down,
or even easier to just and it's real.
Relationship is messy. It's not easy. It's not the fairy tale thing that we like to think it is. Real relationships, meaningful relationships,
involve making mistakes, hurting each other, and forgiving
each other,
and
drawing closer to one another.
But in cancel culture, it's just easier to move on, friend. But
without the cycle of death and resurrection,
in relationship with
sin and reconciliation, relationships remain
shallow, and we're not nourished. And so people
who have suffered from cancel culture,
hey, Don't cancel me.
Don't cancel me. Engage with me. Be in relationship with me. Don't just say I was wrong
or you don't like me.
Let's work it out.
Stop the cancel culture. Both directions. That somebody can go around committing the same sin over and over and over again, and if anybody complains about it,
oh, they're just doing cancel culture. I don't have to repent. It's all that. It becomes another form of what about it? I can't tell you how many times in my ministry
what they did to me.
I hurt.
I love
them.
I miss being in relationship with them.
How do I get my husband
or my wife to apologize? And as we dig deeper into what needs to be apologized for, how many times
somebody's come to me in heartache in that fashion, and as we dig deeper into
the story,
into what they've been through, well, it's not all just one-sided.
And by the time
they've come to me, to a pastor, to reach out, to seek
for help, there's been a lot of water under the bridge, and a lot
of back and forth.
This relationship has been damaged for a while, that there's
a lot of apologizing that needs
to
go.
And that both people are basically
saying that, well, I'm not going to apologize until they apologize.
It's scary to admit we're wrong. It's scary to admit to another person that we've hurt them, because what if they don't forgive us? What if they hold it against us? What if I'm afraid to change my behavior? What if I make the effort and it doesn't work out? Repentance. But our lesson is not just about repentance, it's about baptism. So how are the two connected? I'm going for it. Yoda in the Star Wars movies. The strength of a Jedi flows from the Force, Yoda would say. that the Jedi uses the Force. And that's where the strength of the Jedi comes from. The strength of a Christian comes from our baptism. That when we are baptized, our Lord God looks upon us and says, this is my son, this is my daughter, in whom I'm well pleased. Not because we've done anything special, but because God made us and loves what God has made. That we are loved no matter what. That we need not fear anything. The powerful words of our opening hymn, Almighty Fortress. Were they to take our house, goods, honor, child, or spouse,
though life be wrenched away, they cannot win the day.
The kingdom is ours forever.
It is a gift through baptism. God claims us, you are my child forever, and nothing will take you
away from me.
You need not fear death.
You need not fear nakedness. You need not fear shame. This world, and you do not need to fear even your own sin. That to apologize,
to repent, is not weakness.
It's strength. It's
courage. It's boldness.
To be humble. To repent and to renew the relationship. And so,
yes, the season of Lent is
about repentance. And it's not like some transaction. I repent. Oh, the one you get. No. It's not some random thing that God just arbitrates. Oh, yeah, you repent. I can get the kingdom. No, it's fundamentally connected. Repenting, re-entering that relationship is the kingdom. And the strength to do so, the courage to do so, is in our baptism. Amen. Teaches us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory,
forever and ever.
Amen. You are what God made you to be. Created in Christ Jesus for good works. Chosen
by holy
and beloved. Freed to serve your neighbor. God bless you, that you may be a blessing. In the name of
the Holy and life-giving
Trinity. Ah, I just had it pointed out to me that I skipped right past the Apostles' Creed and the prayers of intercession. I actually skipped past the entire a page of the liturgy. What's that? Let us...
In Jesus, your realm has come near to us in every place and time. Give your church throughout the world a spirit of humility and repentance. Teach us to trust always in the goodness of your salvation.
Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You made a covenant of mercy with every living creature. Protect all earth's creatures from destruction. Direct the words and actions of leaders in our community and throughout the world that they may maintain justice for the lowly. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Even in the wilderness, you are with us. Walk alongside migrants and refugees crossing dangerous lands. Tend to those whose lives feel desolate. Give healing and strength to all who suffer. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In the covenant of baptism, you claim us as beloved children. Nurture us in our baptismal identity and teach us to live within it for the sake of others. Strengthen this congregation's ministries of care and concern. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In baptism, you joined us to the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We praise you for all who have died trusting in your faithfulness. Bring us with them to the fullness of your reign. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
And now a final blessing, and then we'll sing a friend again. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine down upon you and grace you. The Lord look upon your neighbor and keep you.
Amen.
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 say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. All the blessings that I can see. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart,
with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I bless your name.
Thank you, Lord.
I just want to thank you,
Lord.
Thank you.
I just want to thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. For all you've done in my life, you have defied darkness and gave me light. Thank you. My sin and my shame. You took my sickness and healed all my pain. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with outstretched arm, I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Share the good news. Thanks be to God. See you.
You are forgiven. Nice. You too. Good to see you, Tony. Good to see you, Ron. Ward family, Nicole, Jessica. You too. Thanks. Good to